Alright, let's take a quick detour from USMNT for a second and let's talk about Chicago Fire. We left this team alone for a little while. In the last two episodes, I was focused on USMNT. Because, well, the MLS, the MLS Cup and the US Open Cup is a little bit boring. But one thing that is not boring is Continental Cup. I mean, we could talk about CONCACAF Champions League, but it's literally just playing against 15 Mexican teams, so what's the point? I wanna talk about Club World Cup. Besides, Club World Cup is far more interesting because you are literally playing against everybody else in the world. You could play against, I don't know, Real Madrid. I also put Schweinsteiger's introduction in the very first episode, so it kinda tied it all up together.
Is it a fair expectation to see a clear pathway towards a World Cup competition come out of Chicago?
Where is the problem? The original Club World Cup is nearly impossible to win unless you are from Europe. So there was a talk to expand the Club World Cup format into 24 teams. So here is the problem. UEFA said that they will throw the current and the last three Champions League winners and also the current and the last three Europa League winners. There will be 8 groups, so there will be one European team in each group. CONMEBOL likely to send the current and the past winners of Copa Libertadores and Copa Sudamericana. Likely the other confederation do the same. You need to win the Champions League first. In the last 16 years of CONCACAF Champions League, only one winner came from outside of Mexico. And even since the very first start of the tournament in 1962, American teams only went to the final 5 times. And they only won twice. But here we are in 2029. And this is our last shot of winning the entire thing. But now we need to talk about 4 of my longest standing members of the team. They have been there from the beginning and this is everything. The very first player is Emile Franco, a Peruvian American who's originally signed as a desperate move because the GM can't even make a good financial decision. The second player is Yannick Scheidegger, a half-Swiss American who came from Zurich. He is our first properly developed American player to be sold to top 5 leagues. But recently he came back to us because he was released by Sheffield Wednesday. The third player is Scott Pollock. He is a former hashtag United and Northampton player. Now, there are some people in Essex who kept insisting that people should...
I'm Scotty P, remember the name?
Well, I surely remember his name because he has the second most appearances in all competition just behind the goalkeeper we just talked about before. And he is the longest tenured player left in Chicago Fire. And the last player is Joshua Pinedas. He was really famous because he was playing for Ajax Academy before, but then he dipped because, well, he was released and he is pretty productive, so it's pretty good for me, I guess. With that in mind, we need to go into the 2029 Club World Cup. Our first game is against Manchester City. They were aging really bad. Ederson is 35, Niklas Süle is 33, Ben Godfrey is 31. Ruben Neves misplaced a pass and it's a goal for us. And we added one more from a cross headed in by Joshua Pinedas. 2-0 for Chicago Fire. In the second game, we are playing against Internacional, a Brazilian team that were currently in a decline. The only good goal from this game is Scott Pollock scoring this worthy of a goal. That is a great goal. They tied it up with a solo run from Matheus Pereira, but really, that's kinda it. Internacional goalkeeper can't even catch a cold. Positioning sucks, catching sucks. In the quarterfinal, we are playing against Liverpool. It's kinda tough, but it's kinda lucky too, because Liverpool is on a decline. They just finished 6th in the league, and they recently replaced their manager with Nuno Espirito Santo. So yeah, 4-0. That's not supposed to happen, right? That is a bit mad. Wow. They can't defend at all, and a penalty too. I can't even remember what happened there, but it's a penalty, 3-0. And let's make it 4, Yunus Musa to Yannick Scheidegger, and that defense stinks. In the semifinal, we are playing against Beijing Guoan, who played against Chelsea in the last game and they beat them 1-0. But they are playing without their goal scorer in the last game, Sergio Reguilon, because I don't know, I didn't check it. Honestly, I didn't check it. The goal scorer is literally the same as in the very first game against Manchester City. Tino Idlefinger and Joshua Pinedas score for us in a 2-0 victory. In the final, we are playing against Manchester United. Manchester United is a tough team to beat. In the final, we are going to play without our star midfielder, Yunus Musa, whilst Manchester United can't play with some guy called Erling Haaland. This some random Norwegian guy can't even play because an Achilles injury that sidelined him for about 4 months. Now, there might be something interesting with Manchester United's logo. Well, because this team is a bit of a jerk. Now, let's go to the lineup, shall we? There we'll start Mason Greenwood at the top with Marcus Rashford and Nicolò Zaniolo on the wing. And you can see that Manchester United bought two Chelsea players, Kepa and Kai. Why? Meanwhile, my team is basically all regenerated players apart from four players I spoke about in the last segment. So, here goes nothing. Anything happened? Well,
It is what it is.
A free kick from Van der Ley met with a foot, but it was held. Another free kick from Van der Ley and it was met with a header from Tino Idlefinger, and it's 1-0 for Chicago Fire in the 5th minute. That was quick. Now, as you see the game progress, you will see that the lack of striker for Manchester United seems to be a major problem. Here's an attack from Zaniolo. He crossed it to Marcus Rashford and he can't finish it point blank. Chicago Fire tried to mount a counter attack from Nicolas Joachini. He's not a regenerated player, my bad, I'm sorry. But that shooting is not forgivable, that sucks. What is that shot? Okay, that is bad. A counter attack again for Manchester United. Greenwood one-on-one with the goalkeeper. Nobody else on the... What? Mason Greenwood? Come on, you got two legs, bro. Another shot from Greenwood. Long shot and it was nothing. Why do you do that? It's pretty much a stalemate at this point because Chicago Fire is trying to defend their lead whilst Manchester United can't even finish their dinner. Another shot from Rashford and it's straight to goalkeeper. Another shot from Greenwood and it's again straight to the goalkeeper. What are they doing? Zaniolo across to Rashford, straight to the goalkeeper. It's just going like this over and over again. Now this from Van der Ley to Idlefinger again and he scored too. Honestly, he's not even that good. His finishing is 11 for crying out loud. At least he can run. 2-0 for Chicago Fire. Honestly, that came out of nowhere. It was cleared, but a mistake at the back. Teletsea and they just shot straight at the goalkeeper. He crossed it to Zaniolo who takes a long shot and oh my. Emile Franco is a good goalkeeper. I mean, he's not great per se, but when was the last time a Peruvian player, I mean Jefferson Farfan, my bad, he's not even supposed to be good. I don't get it. He is really good. It's now the 80th minute. It's Arthur on the ball. Arthur, a former Barcelona player. Sam Roberts decided to make the game a little bit more interesting for us by tackling Arthur on the box. Why are you doing that, man? Come on. Rashford on the pen and they pegged one back from the spot. Now this is a bit ironic, but to quote Sir Alex Ferguson, it's squeaky bum time. They were trying to bombard us on every single hole possible. Honestly, this entire game is just Manchester United trying to score by shooting straight to the goalkeeper. I mean, 9 shots on target. 9 shots. They only scored 1 and it was from the spot. It was a penalty. Sort your stuff out, man. This is kinda sucks because I didn't record the ending of the game, the celebration, but this entire game is just me getting frustrated because Manchester United can't even score from open play. They suck so bad. What is this, man? The key player for us in this tournament is Tino Adelfinger. He scored 9 goals for us, breaking the record of 8 goals by Antoine Griezmann. He won the best player and the top scorer award. He's also in the dream team. He was an academy player for Philly and he was signed for free to Stuttgart, and I signed him again for free because he was released. So he's not even that good, and Manchester United can't even save themselves from this guy. This tournament is so weird. This year is so weird. Whatever. Let's just forget. Let's just bin this entire episode and let's just skip to the 2030 World Cup because that is our final shot at the entire thing. Well, see you then.